not a religious, but a spiritual interlude. There's a Jewish tradition that music is the soul's way of communicating, that unlike words, which you sometimes can't find quite the right word for a moment, music and dance, these more fluid forms of art are ways that we can truly capture what the soul is trying to communicate. So I hope all of us today will find ourselves lost in the beautiful notes that we're about to hear, and that we can hear what our soul is trying to communicate to us tonight. And this is a free concert, and I know there's donations you saw involved in, and feel free to be generous so that we can keep this concert going year after year. And I, without further ado, I introduce Dr. Stephen Fermil to come and tell us more about what we're going to hear tonight, and welcome you to our Jemaah. Welcome.
It's a delight to be with you again. It's been a wonderful week so far. The 14th annual Port City Music Festival. Yes, we made it through the last couple of years, and this year is really, really very exciting. Of course, want to thank B'nai Israel for partnering with us to bring this concert to you, as with all our partner venues. And of course, we do want to thank the Arts Council of Wilmington, and the Landfall Foundation, of course, and also any of the private individual donors. And if any of you saw in the program, you saw Johnson & Johnson, like, oh, wow, they got Big Pharma sponsoring them too, right, yeah. Well, a lot of these big organizations have matching grant programs, so if any of you used to work for large corporations or currently do, that is something that you could possibly explore. So that is a way to double your gift. So, but let's get to the music here. I'm missing a few people. Guys, want to come out? Please welcome. Very exciting season for us. It's the first time we've been able to have a kind of a city string quartet, a house string quartet, as it were, to really unpack and explore that wonderful literature. You know, the string quartet is often the genre, whether it's chamber music or symphonic or rock or whatever, the genre that many composers have put their best efforts, their most diligent efforts in. Their most artistic thought into it. And so we're delighted to explore that with you. Last night, we played Haydn's first string quartet, Opus 1, number 1, in B flat. And of course, it was, you know, Haydn is the so-called father of the string quartet, not because he created it, but because he really brought it from its infancy to its maturity throughout his 68 quartets that he composed. Of course, in Vienna at the time, Haydn was very influential, and in one batch of his quartets, I believe Opus 33, had a big impression on the young Mozart. And in fact, the two of them would play together this set of quartets in Opus 33, so-called Russian quartets, and with Haydn on the violin and Mozart on the viola, and really made an impression on Mozart, and so. In kind, Mozart composed a set of six quartets, which he called the Haydn quartets, and they were a gift to Haydn. A little more on that in a moment. But the set of six, we're going to play the first one of them in G major. You can see on your program it says break. Okay, well, here's the thing. Exactly. Yeah. Mozart wasn't writing this quartet and saying, I feel like spring. We're going to call it spring. No. This is something that publishers would do, create a gimmick to get more sales, more subscriptions. They're notorious for doing that, and you know, well, can't blame them. But definitely, you know, publishers would name, put, you know, little attributes to quartets or any piece by a composer that they thought might bring in more subscriptions, more sales, and so. Anyway, it's definitely spring-like. It's very joyful, as you'll hear. One of the things that makes the difference, like, this is the difference between Haydn and Mozart. I don't know, they're all the same. But what makes Mozart really stand out is that his music is very chromatic. So what do I mean by chromatic? Well, that's the use of lots of accidentals. What do I mean by accidentals? Accidentals is when there's lots of sharps or flats that are not in the key signature that really expand the color of the music, chromatic. And so this is one of the hallmarks of Mozart's compositional styles, chromaticism. Haydn, not so much. Haydn was very irregular phrases and kind of being, you know, more on the joke side of things. More on the joke bit, a little later at the end of the program. And so when Mozart dedicated these six quartets to Haydn, you know, they're very chromatic, it's his compositional style, put a lot of effort into it, and in turn, that actually influenced Haydn and his later quartets to adopt more chromaticism. And so, no composer is really in a silo. They're all influenced back and forth from each other and really enriching their tradition. About the dedication, and this is, I'm going out on a limb here, okay? I didn't read this on Wikipedia. So this is my thought about a dedication. Back at that time, you know, this is a time where composers were kind of moving from working for the aristocracy and having a lifetime gig and getting a pension and retirement and all that business. Haydn, I think, was one of the last ones that really had that at the court of Esterhazy, so working for royalty. And then as you move forward, Beethoven was probably the first really recognized freelance musician. Yes, and Beethoven is tomorrow, by the way. So Mozart, he was kind of caught in between. He was like that, that Gen X group, you know, they're just not quite sure where to go. But Mozart was not very successful, and of course, if you wanted to get your music known, you would want to dedicate it to a well-known person, preferably wealthy, well-known person, and hopefully get compensated. But I say that because Mozart really had such a high esteem of Haydn, where he dedicated, put a lot of effort to something that really wasn't going to have any return. And I think that's probably one of the greatest artistic endeavors, when you're really creating something for art, for art's sake, without ever thinking this is going to bring you any sort of return. So this is one of, I think, the purest endeavors that we have in our festival. So I'm getting the look from our musicians. Stop talking. Let's hear some Mozart. So this is the G major quartet by Haydn. Mozart. Thank you. So we started the program, we started the festival, kind of an homage to the great Russian musical tradition. And of course, we're highlighting that in five of our concerts with music by Shostakovich and Borodin and last night Rachmaninoff. And so we'd like to, what we started with was Tchaikovsky's Andante in Cabaret, that was that the composer had arranged for cello and piano, sometimes cello and orchestra. But we thought it would be appropriate to bring you the original version of the Andante Cantabile from Tchaikovsky's first string quartet in D major. And again, I can't say it enough, that the great Russian musical tradition belongs to the world, and regardless of what's happening in the world today, this is something that we should all continue to celebrate and continue to own. And so, the very wonderful Andante Cantabile.
Thank you.
So back in 2018, this was the 10th year anniversary of the Port City Music Festival, we piloted a collegiate chamber music program. It's basically a chamber music boot camp for college kids, where they would come in for a week, strangers to each other, make quick friends, rehearse, and then play a concert with another week. One of those students was Shanti Seidel Molina, who is the composer, arranger of the next piece that's about to hear. Of Mexican and Jewish heritage, Shanti was studying in the Washington, D.C. area, and then after graduating, went back to Mexico, and then I think they had been in the Washington State area for a while, and now is back in the D.C. area. But a wonderful, wonderful musician. She played cello. She's a cellist and also a composer. And so she arranged the La Guacamaya, or is that what it's called? Yeah, Guacamaya. And this is a type of folk tune, Son Jarocho, which is from the Veracruz province or state in Mexico. And this Son Jarocho had a lot of different influences, Caribbean influences, European influences, African influences. And really, it was a folk song, a folk art, where it was really kind of musical storytelling, where you would have a group of musicians and a singer, and they're just getting together at a party, and they're just singing about things in the room. They'd sing about the lights in this room. They'd sing about the wonderful windows that you have. And it was a very folky sort of art form. And La Guacamaya is a macaw. It's about a bird. And the bird is very sad because they're cutting his tree down. And he's commenting to the other macaw on the other tree. And it's as simple as that. And it's a folk tune, a wonderful folk tune, that Shanti arranged for string quartet. And we're delighted to bring it to you, and also to lift up the students that we had a few years ago, before times, before pandemic, that were learning and emerging artists, really. And so this is a nod to all the students that have come along with the Port City Music Festival. So, La Guacamaya. where, remember I talked about the joke at the beginning? So, we're a very serious bunch. Sarah's the one with all the jokes in the group, actually. Luigi, maybe you want to talk about this, Luigi.
So, Mozart, you know, had a pretty hard life, even though he wrote a lot of happy music. And his father always was after him for, like he said, writing music that was too hard, too complicated, not approachable, and he didn't sell as much music as all the composers of the time. So, why don't you write like them? You know, a lot of people that we don't know now, they think of my history. So we don't know exactly why Mozart wrote this piece, but he titled it a musical joke. So you have to have a little bit of imagination also to get a joke. But it's actually originally for sextet. So we need two people that can play horn that can join us right now. So it's for string quartet and two horns. But the slow movement, the horns don't play. So we played that for you exactly as Mozart wrote it. In the whole piece, there's all kinds of things happening. The music is kind of boring, because he's trying to write like the other composers at this time, like Stravinsky. So, in this particular piece, the music seems to go somewhere and never gets there, and it switches, and the accents are in the wrong places, and things like that. So that's a part of the joke. But also, in the music, he writes sometimes for the horns, wrong notes that sound like they're cracking the notes. So it's making fun of the horn players that crack notes. And at the end also, he writes two different keys or three different keys in the orchestra. So they end completely out of tune. So that's a great joke too. In this piece we're going to play, he's actually making fun of me in this case, or the first violinist, or the lead leader of the group. Because in the middle of it, there's the cadenza, where the first violinist wants to show off their skills. And it's kind of, you'll still hear it. But it's interesting because he write a whole tone scale, something that is not used in the 20th century. But it's just because he's trying to show that the violinist gets a little too overboard and plays completely out of tune. So I'm playing the notes that he actually wrote. So don't think that I so yeah, this is the adagio, slow movement from Mozart's musical joke.